Mic check.
Mama, what is this book?
Come, my daughter.
Do I put it here?
Okay.
Do I put it on this?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Hello. Welcome, everyone, to the Public Health Grand Rounds at the CUNY School of Public Health. I'm Dennis Nash. I'm the director of the CUNY Institute for Implementation Science and Population Health here at CUNY. And today I'm delighted to introduce our speaker. speaker, who is Till Barnickhausen, here visiting us from the University of Heidelberg in Germany. So Till, as many of you may know from his work, is a very energetic and also very prolific contributor to many different fields related to population health. He did his medical degree at the University of Heidelberg and then went on to get a Master's of Science in Economics, specialized in family medicine, and did a doctorate at the Harvard School of Public Health focused on global health. And more recently, I learned that he has recently completed a sort of MBA kind of equivalent that is sort of bringing a new perspective, an important perspective, it turns out, we may hear, to some of the work that he's been doing in population health. He runs a Global Health Institute at the University of Heidelberg, and as we've talked over the last several months, we both have been on a National Academy of Sciences committee focused on human resources for health in Rwanda, and I've learned a lot about what Till's Institute for Global Health at the University of Heidelberg is focused on, and it's a lot like what our Institute for Implementation Science and Population Health is doing here. And so as we've learned about each other's work, we've become very excited about the potential for collaboration. I'm pleased to say that among his joint appointments, including that at the Harvard School of Public Health, he also now has an appointment with us in the Department of Epidemiology and at the CUNY Institute for Implementation Science and Population Health. So that's great. And I guess before I turn it over to Till, I just want to say another thing where his work has been influential on our work as well, specifically in the area of quasi-experimental designs that we have used in regression discontinuity designs. This is something that is a unique contribution of Till's, in my view, which sort of bridged methods that were used for causal inference in economics into the field of epidemiology, and they're since becoming more mainstream use in our field. And I think a lot of the credit can go to your training in both fields and bringing some of the methods into us. So, Till, welcome. We're very excited to have you here. Thank you very much. And welcome to Till Barnickhausen.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dennis. Thank you for the invitation. And if I could freely name our own institute, I would name it exactly using the name that Dennis has chosen for his center, Implementation Science for Population Health for Global Health. Clearly, this is a development that has been with us in population health for a long time now, and maybe for the last 10 years, our funders have increasingly asked where is the relevance of your work. And we've increasingly become important because we are intervention scientists, we implement in real life. And I'll show you one logic of such implementation science. It is one of many different logics that can exist, and it reflects broadly in methods the work at the institute that I'm leading, the Heidelberg Institute of Global Health. Heidelberg is Germany's oldest university, our Oxford school, and we are very united at the institute in focusing on this type of research in methods. We're very broad in our domain. Here I'm presenting two domains that I'm pursuing myself. At the Institute, we have a group on climate change and health, on maternal and child health, on health economics. So we are much broader than what I'm presenting here. And I'd be thrilled to link to people, and would be fantastic to collaborate broadly at institutions as well as persons.
Mic check.
Is it better now? Yes, but everyone can hear me quite well. So what deeply motivates us is this graph. You know what I'm showing here? I could be showing many things, but what is the plausible burden of disease, and I and Dennis and many colleagues are participating. 700 author papers. they typically don't count for our digestive disease, and they shouldn't. But what is the picture of the world that I'm showing?
It
could be many burdens of disease. So here it is in particular life expectancy. And we have these different world regions. What is life expectancy in the region that is in orange here, roughly? Yeah, it's around 60. And then we have life expectancy in these regions of the world. The darker blue, the better. And it is in the mid to high 90s. So there is a more than 20-year gap. Life expectancy, and this is a gap that could be eliminated. There's no need for this gap, and it motivates us. And the other underlying motivation for our work, I think, is that we do indeed have the capability to change health and health metrics and outcomes such as life expectancy. And here's an example from the last decade, the largest investment the world has made in the last decade in health.
Oh, is it Mike? Okay, fine. Thanks. So the biggest investment the world has made in the last decade globally has been for one disease, HIV, to the tune of about $10 billion per year we are investing in this disease. And here is an example. It was the first empirical measurement suggesting the powerful life expectancy effects of HIV treatment for everybody free of charge in the public sector. This is in KwaZulu-Natal, one of the communities worldwide where most severely affected by the HIV epidemic, where we still see this declining life expectancy here. This is adult life expectancy on the y-axis. This declining life expectancy going towards the time when South Africa finally decides to make HIV treatment available free of charge in the public sector. And this trend here is a total exception in this world. As you know, life expectancy is increasing nearly universally worldwide. There are recent doubts, I know, in the United States, but let's leave that aside. All countries worldwide have constantly increasing life expectancy, high-income countries, middle, low-income countries. The one exception to this basic rule have been those countries where HIV severely or affected large proportions of the population, such as in South Africa, in Eswatini, in Lesotho. And there we've seen dramatic decreases in life expectancy. And we know that in South Africa and in KwaZulu-Natal locally, life expectancy in the 90s, in the 80s, was around in the high 60s. And now we see a community here 30 years into the HIV epidemic, and adult life expectancy has fallen below 50. So we have this one disease and now this very powerful response to it, free public sector treatment, and we see one of the fastest life expectancy increases in lockstep with ART rollout in the public sector. Clearly, this is simply descriptive epidemiology. What gives us a bit of faith that this could indeed be a causal relationship is this series of points here. This is empirically measured in a large population, entire community population cohort in rural KwaZulu-Natal. Here is the HIV cause deleted life expectancy. That is the life expectancy amongst those people who die of HIV unrelated causes. And it remains very stable at 70. If anything but HIV treatment were responsible for this dramatic increase, it's one of the fastest we've seen in the history of public health, to the tune of 1 year life expectancy gain per calendar year. If anything else had been responsible for this overall life expectancy increase, such as better sanitation, better hygiene, better nutrition, electrified households, we would have expected to see increases in the HIV cause deleted life expectancy, which we don't see. And this is a life expectancy recovery. So we've seen similarly fast-paced life expectancy recoveries when the plague disappeared from Europe, when the influenza pandemic 1918 disappeared. We've seen these recoveries. We cannot achieve such a fast life expectancy increase with development. The slow ongoing life expectancy increases worldwide are deep structural development. So what we do in the healthcare sector can have traumatic effects. And that is a second major motivation for us. And the third motivation comes, it's now 15 years since we published this article in 2004, where we gave a finding to the world that is very suggestive only, causally weak, and seems very trivial. And it wasn't trivial at the point. So 15 years ago, we were in a period when World Bank had been arguing and some health economics studies had been suggesting that adding health workers to places doesn't do anything for life, for mortality, for morbidity. And indeed, if we added another 10 cardiologists to New York, cardiovascular mortality in New York will not be affected. It may actually go down a little bit because of backward bending supply curves in medicine and overprovision of stent services. So we have this situation of saturation in many high-income countries. In the low and middle-income settings, an additional doctor, an additional nurse will make a big difference. It's a trivial point to show, but it was a first amongst other articles that came later that demonstrated and quantified what an additional doctor in a low-income community can buy in terms of mortality reduction, infant mortality, under five mortality, maternal mortality. And it was one of the empirical studies that went into the 2006 World Health Report. This was a time, some of you will remember these initiatives associated with it, when the world committed heavily in ensuring that there are enough physicians and enough midwives and enough nurses in Africa. And we are now 15 years later, and this is a recent picture. We just published this in Implementation Science in an editorial, and this is just suggestive. I could have put and selected very different countries to make the same point. We are still in a world where we have a huge gradient in poor countries in terms of amenable mortality. Do you know what amenable mortality is? It's another important metric. It's the mortality that we can successfully eliminate if we did everything we currently can do with our technologies, our knowledge in the healthcare sector through the healthcare sector. It's mortality that is not attributable to other sectors, and we can address it through the healthcare sector. So here in three high-income countries in Europe, Germany, France, UK, we have low amenable mortality still a bit. And that's understandable. Not everybody wants health services. We are free countries. So we will not expect to be able to eliminate it perfectly. But we have a huge gradient here and large amenable mortality in Ethiopia, Ghana, and South Africa still to this date. And then we see the inverse care law at play here. In Germany, we spend 4,000 euros per person. In the UK, we spend in the healthcare sector 3,000 euros per person. And we have 4,000 physicians, 4 physicians per 1,000 population in Germany. We have 0.04 physicians per 1,000 population in Ethiopia. In the city where I live, 150,000 people, we would have on average 1.5 physicians, according to this population count in Ethiopia. So this gradient and the dearth and scarcity of health workers in low-income settings has not disappeared. It has remained. We have not been successful in achieving what in 2006 the World Health Report asked us to achieve with interesting initiatives, powerful policies, ethical recruitment policies. It has not helped. We still are in a place where we have maybe too many doctors in some settings, or at least enough, and nurses and midwives, and hardly any in other places in the world. And this motivates our work, because we work, if you will, on making healthcare available to everybody in need with means that are realistic today, that are feasible today, that are technically and financially sustainable. And in implementation science, the way we see it, we start with an assessment of need and unmet need. We then move to design studies, active creative studies, research as design. We then evaluate the intervention in the impact. And we also do the science of engagement, and we also have to become better in engaging with policymakers, in co-creating with our stakeholders in the community level at national levels. So a few examples of each of these categories of methods. But if you have any questions, we should do them as they come. So are there any questions? I could give you the microphone if that's the way to do it. Do you have a question?
No, yeah. I have the mic.
Okay. Yes.
One of the biggest struggles has been patient care compliance with the treatments and the treatment regimens. How do you factor for that in your various ranges of analyses?
Yeah, great. So clearly, retention and adherence, compliance are important aspects that we need to get right, and we need to empower people to adhere well, right? So we do these studies. As an overall stylized fact in the work that we do on large diseases and important diseases, there are major retention and adherence and compliance issues, and we lose effective healthcare, we lose potential impact due to compliance, but we lose much more because people never appear in the healthcare system. And we're typically in an already quite good space when a person is in a primary care clinic on treatment. They will not be retained, some will not adhere, but in our own work where we have sort of shown the entire cascade from need that everybody has who has a certain condition to successful treatment, we see that the larger losses are typically in the earliest stages when a person has to come to a facility where healthcare is available. But then once they're there, retention and adherence, compliance become very important. And clearly we can do in intervention research a lot, and a lot has been done to study in RCTs, for instance, for HIV treatment, for instance, in sub-Saharan Africa, how we can enhance adherence through SMS messages, through treatment supporters, through additional food parcels that are given to people who come back to the clinics and promise to adhere well. So I think we've learned a lot about adherence, but there's still a lot more work to do. Yeah, yeah. No, it's an absolutely great question. And this graph speaks to your question, which is excellent. And it shows, we did here for the first time a longitudinal HIV treatment cascade. So we see here on the y-axis, and this is a measure of need, but in a cascaded way, we have here on the y-axis everybody who is HIV positive and in need of treatment, in need of linking to care. And here we have time, 4 years. This is measured in an entire community of 150,000 people. And we see through a research-based HIV testing program, everybody who is positive. We also ask, do you know your status? We also offer to give people status information, but they're not required to be tested with us. Public sector may be more convenient, more private, maybe better. And here we have all positives who are tested in this population-wide surveillance who say they don't know they're positive. And then we see the cumulative incidence of learning that you're positive when indeed you are. And we see how much loss there is. Essentially, the white space here is the loss. And after 4 years' time in this time period, these are different cohorts in time, 2010 to 2011, starting at 0.0 here. 4 years later, in 2015, maybe a third of people who are positive have learned that they are positive and thus can link. And this is the next population stage of this cascade. I would call these first stages knowing that you have a condition, linking to care, the population-based stages of a cascade. What follows are the health systems-based stages. So now linkage is even somewhat worse. We see that those who know they're positive after 4 years, maybe 25% or so, have gone to a clinic and have sought treatment. Then when we have initiated for HIV treatment here, when people are successfully on treatment, the success rate is actually, or very quickly, does this outcome evolve? This speaks, if you will, to the rapidity, to the performance of the system in getting people onto care. And now comes your good point. What do we lose in terms of non-adherence, non-compliance to medication? So these are all people who are initiated on treatment, they get treatment. And this is the cumulative incidence of having successful treatment as defined by viral load suppression in the blood for HIV care. When we can no longer find virus in your blood, you are successfully treated as a clinical outcomes definition. And we see that there are still losses, the white space, and there's still a distance to go from 100%. So amongst everyone who is treated, in the end, after 4 years, maybe 20% remain virally unsuppressed. And these are the non-adherent people. So there is a loss here. It's relatively small. It's important in absolute terms. It's relatively small to the big losses at the beginning of the cascade in the population. And whenever we look, right, this stylized finding is similar. This we just published last month in The Lancet. It's a long time since we've worked on this article here. And it has a long history. I was on the Lancet Commission for Diabetes in Africa, and I had naively promised to do population representative diabetes cascades. And I thought I could do this because we had done it in the HIV world, where we have the Demographic and Health Service and the AIDS Indicator Service, and they give us data. They're publicly available on the push of a button. And I had looked online and I'd seen there are the WHO STEP surveys. And I optimistically promised to the other commissioners, we will do the diabetes and hypertension cascades for our Lancet commission. And then I asked for the data and I found that it is not publicly available. So we started to write all these STEP survey indicators. It's actually a bit of a scandal that it isn't publicly available because it's funded by WHO by, in the end, our tax contributions, and the world should have access to this important data. That's a normative point I would like to make. But here now we are in a good situation because we have access now to about 75% of the STEP surveys and other nationally representative biomarker surveys for NCDs. Hypertension, anthropometry, measurement, diabetes, biomarkers. And here we've shown for the first time for 44 countries, all low and middle income countries, all the countries where we have such nationally representative, directly physically measured blood pressure and uptake data. And we show the cascade, 100% are the hypertensive patients. Forget this column in a sense, The Lancet forced us to put it in. It carries no information, it has no confidence interval because it is not measured. It is here the 100%. That's the first column, everybody who is hypertensive. And here comes now the next stage, everybody who has been screened. And this is where a difference across region becomes visible. Some regions in this world do better. Latin America, Europe do better regarding screening than Southeast Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. But what is very striking here is that in the end, in Latin America and the Caribbean region and in low and middle income Europe, maybe 20%, 15 to 20% of hypertensive patients are controlled in the hypertension. In Southeast Asia and in Sub-Saharan Africa, it is around 10%. So there isn't a world region in our view here where more than 80% of hypertensive patients are successfully treated in their hypertension. And that's powerful. Most need that we have for chronic care remains unmet, and that's a worldwide phenomenon. And here's my last example. This was, in the end, for the Lancet Commission, a paper that we published in the Lancet, Diabetes and Endocrinology. Very similar picture for Sub-Saharan Africa here, 22 countries. Unmet need for diabetes is near universal. We have amongst people who are overweight and obese, who by most national guidelines should have a blood sugar measurement to test for diabetes, 20% have ever been screened for diabetes. Amongst people who need insulin, 90% do not get insulin. Amongst people who need oral antidiabetics, maybe 80% do not get it. And these are medications that are not expensive. Insulin is a different matter. You need supply chains, you need cold chains, but oral antidiabetics, we have very cheap drugs in the mix of effective drugs on WHO's essential drug list. So that's my introduction and short overview of a few illustrating examples of this descriptive population epidemiology that we do to estimate need and unmet need. Any thoughts, questions? I'm grateful for your motivating question about adherence and compliance.
Lack of control are very different from Europe and Eastern Mediterranean than they are from Sub-Saharan Africa. I would have imagined that the differences would be more than 10%. Actually, this slide is somewhat disturbing. So how do you explain such a failure, especially in European and East Mediterranean countries, that only double the patients are controlled in Europe than they are in Sub-Saharan Africa? Isn't that somewhat shocking?
Yeah, great question. Totally shocking. One little qualifying remark, it is Europe middle income. So we don't have high income Europe in that mix because the STEP surveys aren't done in high income countries. We would have loved to look at high income. In Germany, I heard the number that 40% of hypertensive patients are not successfully treated. So still a large proportion, but much better than these numbers. But the number may be wrong, and it's just a number people have told me, which is a national estimate for Germany. So shocking numbers, and you're absolutely right. The next stage is why and what can we do about it? And in as far as we could in this Lancet piece, we and the reviewers asked for that, we described a few case studies from Latin America. So we have a graph in there on outliers, right? Those countries that versus their predictive values do much better than comparator countries. And we look at what do they do, or they do much worse, what do they do? So we went into the literature in the discussion section and describe, and that generates a few hypotheses. But the hard work yet needs to be done. What is underlying it could be very different mechanisms. Clearly, the cascades do look different, right? So Latin America succeeds in screening, but it isn't doing much better than Sub-Saharan Africa in putting people in need of antihypertensive care on treatment. So now to find out really what are the very likely, very different, even at the country level, right? These were regional pictures. What are the differences? And then how can we address successfully given these differences in each country, in each region. Completely concur with your implicit suggestion based on this data. And this comes to the second point, and this is, we just had this fantastic conversation over lunch, but we have painfully learned that we need to do the second stage in implementation science, which is creating interventions. And here is my example where I have learned it through a very painful scientific failure. It's a failure shared with other well-intended people worldwide. The world, as you know, had invested in the last years in four large, very expensive HIV treatment as prevention trials in Sub-Saharan Africa. They were intended to test the hypothesis whether universal coverage or near universal coverage of HIV positive people with HIV treatment can significantly reduce HIV incidence. And this is a $30 million trial. And now we are later here. It's cluster community. It's a community, a cluster random controlled trial. You see here the intervention communities and the control communities. In the intervention communities, universal test and treat is offered, and we do home-based HIV testing and encourage people to come to the clinics. In the control arm, we also go to all the homes and test for HIV. We also encourage to go, but the clinics where people are eligible to receive HIV treatment offer it under the current, at the time, South African HIV treatment guidelines, which is below a certain CD4 count threshold, below 350, a little bit later below 500. And we see absolutely no difference in population incidence in control and intervention arm. And this is not a failure of an intervention. This is a failure of science. And the failure of science is visible in these little numbers here, art coverage. And necessarily, this intervention, this policy intervention needs to work its way through art coverage, is the same in intervention and control arms, 45% in the intervention arm, 43% in the control arm. In order to be able to show any difference here due to the policy, we would have needed to substantially raise the art coverage in the intervention arm, maybe to 60%, 70%, 80%. I think we were powered here to detect a difference starting sort of at 66%. So we would have needed to have some differential art coverage. Without that, we are just unable to see and to show what we set out to see and to show. And it's a scientific failure, and it's a painful failure because there are opportunity costs to everything we do. Should we have invested in different science, and should we have engaged in design work? And I think deeply the reason why people do not come, because our offer is not desirable, and we did not work with our potential clients on finding the right form, shape, smell, and touch of what we're offering to make it desirable to people in early disease stages. And this is why I think in implementation science, we have to often mostly start with the design phase. And here's an example, and it's an example of design work in a narrow definition, and I'll just show it to you because I think it's powerful. We are currently doing a randomized controlled trial of mentor mother enhanced or enhanced support for mentor mothers in Khayelitsha in Cape Town, South Africa. Khayelitsha is an informal settlement in Cape Town, one of the largest informal settlements or slums, if you will, worldwide, where a community health worker program has been running for many decades, where older, experienced women who've had many children are mentoring younger children to be to do the right things in pregnancy, to give good nutrition to their children, to exclusively breastfeed. So it's a successful mentoring program. And we are testing here in a trial whether a set of videos that we produce together with Stanford, the Center for Medical Education, for Health Education, if a set of 15 short videos, sort of 2 to 5 minutes long, can enhance the quality and standardize the quality of the support that mentor mothers give. And we do this guided by a very complex, but in this case, very useful framework. It's often a good idea. And I think there is some strong and emerging evidence that designs that are supported by a theoretical framework are likely better designs. Here we use the extended elaboration likelihood model to design our intervention. And we work here with powerful design partners. So I formally learned human-centered design methods at the HEC in Paris, one of Europe's best business schools. But we also work with the Hasso-Plattner Institute at the University of Potsdam. Hasso-Plattner is the guy who also funds the D School at Stanford, where a lot of design thinking, human-centered design methods originated. He has a second school in his home country of Germany, and they are a great collaborating partner. And here we worked with the Center of Health Education at Stanford to design a video, and I just want to show you this process. It has been powerful learning. It's design in the narrow sense, because here we are designing a video. We are designing pictures. We are designing symbols. Clearly, design thinking has other levels. We can design human systems. We can design management processes. We can design things, artifacts, machines. Here it is symbolic design. And this shows you how much that can teach us and how in hindsight, we are very naive, but we didn't anticipate. So we wanted to create these 15 videos. Maya Adam at Stanford is leading this work. And here is a starting point, and it's published in JAMA, this little history of an intervention where we produce a video. Maya produces with local South African partners a video, and we find out ourselves it is not something that can ever scale, because the video takes time and it takes money, and then it is very locally specific. We cannot use this video in Burkina Faso, simply because people look different and people in Burkina Faso will not relate to this picture. We also cannot afford it. So we ourselves come up with the next approach, and we have the interesting idea to try a cartoon. And we hire cartoon artists, and they come up with this very lifelike drawing. And these drawings are still too expensive because we need to hire someone very qualified to draw such lifelike pictures. We cannot afford it at scale in many is, right? This is someone who really knows their craft and their expensive human resources. And the next design goes wrong in the other way. It is almost too simple, and it is the wrong color, the wrong shape, and the potential clients, mentor mothers, and mentee mothers in Khayelitsha tell us this is not right, and you can see why it is not right. The next one is this one, looks much better, but a bit too complex. Again, we get some positive, some negative feedback. Again, we take it back to the designers. We get this out of focus groups, out of engagement with local clients. This is in collaboration with Pilani, a non-governmental organization in South Africa, led by Ingrid de la Rouge, who was the first physician that Nelson Mandela saw when he came out of Robben Island back into freedom. She's still alive. She's leading this NGO and works here with us. And the design work evolves. And the next design that, based on the feedback the designers came up with, is this one. And now we have overshot. It's too simple. This is icon character. People don't like it. It's too juvenile, too cartoony. It's too simple. And people find it almost disrespectful. So finally, we come to this version. Again, there's feedback. And very finally to this version. And I'll show you the video that Maya Adam and her team at Stanford have produced and we are using in this study. And I've learned how to do this. I thought. Yeah. Oh, one more time. And now, yes, here or here. This one? Awesome. No. Double click. Yeah.
Mama, what is this book?
Do you recognize?
Come, my darling, let me show you. This is our new Baby's Road to Health booklet. It helps us to keep her healthy. There is information about how to feed our baby, how to love and protect her, and when she needs to visit the clinic for her next immunization. There is even a place where we can keep track of how well she is growing. Look. When your sister got sick last month, I remembered learning about the danger signs from your Road to Health booklet, and I knew we had to take her to the clinic right away. Do you remember the kind lady who took care of her there? She thanked us for remembering to bring your sister's Road to Health booklet. She told us there's even a lot of important information for health workers in that little book. And side by side, we can make sure you and your sister grow up healthy and happy.
Mama, do you think I could be a health worker when I grow up?
My darling, I think you could be anything you want to be. I believe in you. May your road to health be long and happy.
Voice that you heard, and this is another nice feature about this video. So Maya was able to, do you know Zolani from this picture? Do you know Freshly Crowned? It's a African fusion band. They did the World Cup song with Shakira. It's a terrible song. Otherwise, they do good music. But Zolani, who is a star in South Africa and has a recognized and excellent voice, is our voiceover on some of these videos. She is from Cape Town, and she stars in the soap opera in South Africa that plays in Cape Town. So this is a fantastic feature. So remember the voice that you heard. Remember Zolani Mahola. Now, one little addition to design. So we have the situation that we've designed a video locally with local input, but we want to do a very similar study and intervention eventually in Burkina Faso. Burkina Faso is one of the poorest countries in sub-Saharan Africa. South Africa is the wealthiest country in sub-Saharan Africa. And of course, it is a very different culture, very different situation. And we are transferring here to this new context from Cape Town, urban South Africa, to Nuna, rural Burkina Faso, as a marker of to make it visible for you where we are now, going from Cape Town to rural South to rural Burkina Faso. In this setting, household income on average is $350 per year. So these are people who live under the poverty line by most poverty indices. And here is the adaptation. It is still very much cheaper to adapt a cartoon than to film a new video. It is still very much cheaper to take the narrative, to take the story and some of the shapes and simply to rearrange them. This is something I learned here. These video cartoon artists, they have different stages and different layers, and you can go back a layer to the more abstracted version and then put on a new, more concrete version. So this is a marginal effort, and we do it here for very little money and relatively quickly with a PhD student who engages with the Burkina Bé mentor mothers and mentee mothers and local stakeholders. So this is the seasons in Cape Town. Here are the seasons in Burkina Faso. Here is soya in Cape Town. Here is soya in Burkina Faso. Here is the mum in Cape Town. Here is the mum in Burkina Faso. Here is shopping in Cape Town. Here is shopping in Nuna, Burkina Faso. Here is the child in Cape Town. And here is the child in Burkina Faso. And you see the subtle but important differences in these two children. So that's part of design. It is the adaptation to local contexts. And we can learn how to do this well. There's also some learning for me. I had thought this is very necessary. I had also thought we wouldn't be able to publish it. But of course, this is a completely wrong mindset. Creation is science, and we can do creation with scientific methods. It is design for research and research through design. So there are journals that like this type of work. This is here JAMA, where also Dennis, you have recently published, and it has an impact factor of 5, which is okay for us, right? When we come from health systems research, and it is open access and visible to the world. And that's an important next stage. And any questions to this category of methods and approaches? So now the next one is the evaluation stage. And I think design is something that traditionally we were not trained in. I was at least nearly purely evaluatively trained. And we evaluate in experiments and in quasar experiments, does it work? Here is it's actually 2019, a recent publication where we thought, what are the potential delivery model innovations in the HIV sector? How can we ensure that those people who don't know even to this date that they're HIV positive in resource poor communities worldwide know that they're HIV positive, those people who are still not coming to the clinics, will be reached with effective HIV treatment. And we have here looked at a range of delivery model innovations. We can integrate HIV treatment into other systems, but we can also modify steps in the value chain of producing good health to art and eliminate some of the steps and changing the locations where care is provided. So this is our basic background here to these trials. So here are some examples. Here we tested whether female sex workers can help their peers in delivering HIV self-testing. And imagine how major change that is, that we had maybe who here has tested for HIV ever in their lives. I think that's probably a near universal yes. And probably many of you still tested under these old approaches where we had to sign informed consent forms and people guaranteed our confidentiality. And it was a very separate process. Versus who here was ever tested for some other STI, right? The physician or the nurse will just do it. cancer screening, anemia screening, TB screening. The physician just does it, right? And there's no opt-out. Nobody even asks us if we want this. Nobody ensures that our privacy is protected. In HIV testing, we were in this very special world a decade ago. We've now gone completely the other way. HIV self-testing is available over the counter in many pharmacies in many countries worldwide. In South Africa, a test about a month ago cost me 40 rand divided by 17, I think, or by 15, you are in dollars. So it's a cheap test. It's a high-performing test. And now here we're testing in a country, Uganda, where it isn't available over the counter yet, what we could do for female sex workers who are, of course, one of the populations that needs testing most urgently because they have the highest HIV risk worldwide, right? This is one of the population that faces the highest HIV risk, female sex workers in urban Uganda, in Kampala. And the picture I just showed was one of the brothels in which we worked. In our design research, the female sex workers tell us it has to be through a peer. So here we're testing three arms. We're testing HIV self-testing in two delivery modalities, provision through a peer into your hand, or you get a coupon, you can pick it up free of charge in a healthcare service. And standard of care, no HIV self-testing. It's a cluster RCT of 120 clusters and a total of about 1,000 participants. And here we see these powerful effects. So we're able to boost through the peer provision, the peer educator provision of an HIV self-test, HIV testing by about 30%. And even more encouragingly, we can boost repeated HIV testing by about 50%. That's a major increase and a powerful demonstration of effectiveness. WHO prescribes female sex workers to test every 3 months simply because they are such high risk of HIV infection. And here this is twice testing in 4 months, boosted by 50%. That's powerful. But you might say it's a bit trivial and you're clearly giving something that is desirable to people. They cannot take it, but they can now test in their own time and place. The reason why we do implementation science, I think, is often this graph, the incidental, the accidental findings, the afterthought, the unintended consequence. And here we show the causal effect on linking to or testing in a facility and being in a facility. And we see here that with self-testing, very plausible, we are crowding out facility-based testing. And the negative in here is that if you test in the facility, you're automatically linked because where you have tested, treatment is also available. In the home test, in your own time, in your own space, you're far away from treatment. And now you still need to go. And our test, our provision approaches have a very strong negative effect on facility-based testing. It's understandable, but it's powerful to measure and demonstrate it. It doesn't mean that HIV self-testing isn't good, but it means we need to support linkage. I'm very convinced. And we've showed that it's safe and can work also in, this is a community health worker study. So another approach to bring people into treatment and testing is bringing it to the home, taking it out of the healthcare system into the place where a person lives. And community health workers, of course, have great potential to reach people in their unmet need to never come to facilities. And here we tested something very simple. We work with the existing community health worker cadre in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania. They're called HBC, home-based carers. They're supervised and mentored by a community-based nurse who actually sits in a clinic. This is a picture. These two people have consented to be on this picture. This is a community-based nurse, one of our nurses participating in this study. She is in a primary care clinic. This is one of the community health workers that work with her, and she is instructing them. They meet every Friday. We train these community health workers for the first time to do something active. They are, to this time, a purely counseling, information, communication cadre. They support knowledge. They support good understanding of what we can do for our health. but they're not actively treating. And now they're incorporated into a treatment program. They actually bring the medicines to the homes, to the huts where people live. They do adherence screening. They do side effect and adverse event screening. We give them 3 days of training, not a lot. They only have some training after high school. They haven't gone to uni and certainly not as a nurse for 3 years. And here is the random design. We randomize all primary care clinics in the entire city of Dar es Salaam, East Africa's largest city. There are 50 clinics actually that deliver ART. 2 we couldn't work in because I think ICAP was doing trials in these clinics. But in 48 we could work. We randomized them to community delivery. In your home, the community health worker brings the medicines to your doorsteps and counsels and supports you, versus you have to come to the clinic and then a nurse works with you in engaging you continuously on treatment. And this is the outcome. This is a non-inferiority trial because the policymakers in Dar es Salaam who had asked for this study, in part because Tanzania, for reasons nobody really understands, is one of the highest cost country per patient per year on ART in sub-Saharan Africa. So there's pressure on government to make the service provision, HIV treatment and care, cheaper. And community health workers seem to the government very plausibly cheaper. They earn a fraction. They earn about a tenth of what a nurse earns. So here they're not after superiority, but after non-inferiority. And indeed, community health workers are as good as nurses in delivering HIV treatment by our pre-specified registered primary endpoint of viral suppression, which is a very good clinical marker of treatment success. We see that community health workers are a little bit better. They achieve, they have viral failure, the negative, with about 9-10%, and the standard of care arm nurses have a little bit higher viral failure of 11%. Both arms are very good in achieving viral failure. And what is encouraging, and this again is what we need to do in implementation science, this is the descriptive finding, patients are also satisfied with the care they receive. I was very suspicious that patients would not like care delivered by a community health workers because they know a community health worker has not received 3 years of university-based training as a nurse. They know the community health worker is almost a lay health cadre. And still, it is highly satisfactory to receive treatment in Dar es Salaam brought to your doorsteps by a community health worker. So this is powerful. This slide was meant to be before. It's the Zambian version of our HIV self-testing trial. But here is my last trial as an example, where we tested universal test and treat in Eswatini, the policy that HIV treatment is available for everybody, not only for those who have been infected and are in advanced disease stages now for some time. It's a step batch trial with a range of collaborators here in Eswatini, Clinton Health Access Initiative, the Eswatini government. Eswatini, incidentally, was called Swaziland 2 years ago. It is now the Kingdom of Eswatini, in case anyone had wondered. And here is our step batch design, our steps. And we assign 2 clinics in each step randomly, in a random paired way. And our major interest here is a worry that when it is opened up to everybody, patient satisfaction could change in a major way. One reason for this worry is when you open up HIV treatment to everybody, there will be more patients, patient load goes up, already overworked nurses are even more overworked, and they start to have less time for patients, maybe be more stressed, less engaging, and patient satisfaction goes down. The other reason for a worry here is that the patient composition will change. A patient who comes onto treatment in the old standard, when you're already infected with, when you're already living with HIV for 6-7 years, you have experienced some of the symptoms, you may be more tolerant of side effects of feeling nauseous, having bad nightmares on efavirenz. So possibly you are less satisfied with treatment and care when you enter treatment in a very healthy state versus having experienced some measure of the disease. So people were worried that patient satisfaction would decline. In fact, we see here in this RCT neither overall patient satisfaction nor particular dimensions of the patient experience get worse. So this is encouraging and good. And interestingly, and this is again, I think, why we do and have to do implementation science. Someone else might have said the story you're telling here is implausible. I don't believe there will be any effect on patient satisfaction. But when we look and we see other things in our data that we didn't even think about, we see powerful other effects. And here we see that patient satisfaction is getting worse. A higher score here means worse patient satisfaction over time. These are our steps, the ones I showed over several years. And we see a dramatic increase in both intervention and control arm, controlling for whether you are in the intervention or control arm in patient satisfaction, suggesting that probably the increased patient volumes in all clinics just driven by HIV treatment efforts leads to a reduction in patient satisfaction. Whatever the reason, this is your question again, what are the mechanisms, what are the underlying reasons, but it is an alarming signal because in the long run, why do we care about patient satisfaction? On the one hand, I would argue for intrinsic reason, it is almost a human right. It is intrinsically right that patients should be satisfied with their care. They should receive respectful care and have physicians explain and nurses explain. But also for instrumental reasons, a dissatisfied patient is far more likely to not be retained in care, to not adhere well to care, to not be compliant. So important to show it. And the second endpoint here in this trial, a paper we are currently working on, is does the cost of care change? And for policymakers, that was important. So the average cost of care we show here powerfully because it's a causal impact effect size from an RCT does not change. Intervention arm, control arm, intervention arm, control arm for overall cost per patient per year and for particular dimensions of costs, personnel, drugs, medicines, personnel, and other supporting labs, CD4 counts, and so on. And this is something quite new. Typically, when we do a costing study in implementation science, we describe the costs and we make certain assumptions about the patterns of costs based on direct measurement, but descriptive. Here, we have actually causally established the effect of a new policy on average cost. We have endpoints that are costs. And I think that is important and we should always remind ourselves that we can have cost endpoints in randomized controlled trials. We typically don't do that. I think it's important and powerful. Any questions to experiments? Please ask a question because otherwise I'm not allowed to go over time and I realize I'm going over time. Yes.
So one of the important principles I learned in social marketing is the importance of service flow. How many instances of service that contribute to senses of satisfaction among the patients and the care that they receive are present? Is there initial waiting? Is there a registration, a follow-up, seeing the physician, seeing the nurse, seeing whoever, if that makes sense, as basically the process becomes much more complex with each level of a person or agent that plays a role in the process?
Yeah, no, great question. So clearly we would like to do now quite a few patient journey maps, precise understanding of processes that we see here. Essentially, there is a huge potential for process and journey and patient experience improvement. For instance, in sub-Saharan Africa, as you will know, there isn't a pre-scheduling of appointments, but patients simply come. And depending on when they came on a particular day, they have to wait longer or less long. So it is almost a waste of time on the patient side because you are not pre-scheduled to come at 1 o'clock and then within half an hour you're seen, you just come and then you have to wait. And I think patient journey maps and other process, swim lane approaches will be important here in the long run to ensure that the processes are optimized. I think there's huge potential to do that in many primary care clinics in sub-Saharan Africa.
Has anyone ever thought of generalizing your approaches or your methods to other conditions, for, say, other chronic conditions that involve a behavioral component? Not that I'm going to give my idea away, but I just wanted to know, has anyone ever thought of expanding even further upon your incredible research? And I really, I've just been loving this presentation so far.
Yeah, awesome. So I agree with you. It is absolutely a major potential, again, untapped, to leverage community health workers. So community health workers, as an example, right, of a cadre we could leverage, is the only cadre available in most sub-Saharan African countries at the population concentration as physicians are in the United States. I think in the United States, we have about 3 physicians per 1,000 population. In Ethiopia, we have, that's a number I know, 3 physicians per 1,000, 3 community health workers per 1,000 population. So leveraging community health workers for other chronic care screening and treatment is powerful, and we need to find out how to do it, if it works, and also work with governments on the legislation and the enabling factors that are necessary. Self-testing. I deeply believe we could do a lot more empowering patients with online education, giving them information, but I think we could do much more with self-testing. As a very simple vision, and I'm not sure, Dennis, if you would be sharing that, but what we can do as a point of care test by a health worker, theoretically a person could also do for themselves and for their families. And so empowering patients to do more self-testing is, even ideologically, I would believe it is the right thing to do. We are trusting you. You are an agent of your own fate. Giving you more information that you have control over is, in a first instance, a good idea. And then we have to think about abuse, misdiagnosis, accuracy of interpretation of test results, and so on. But to leverage self-testing, community health worker approaches, and other technological alternatives to health education, screening, and care is absolutely sort of the world we're in health systems research broadly. And now experiments are great because we can test innovations. When we want to test causal impacts in the world of the SDGs, where health to some extent has been relegated to one of many 17 goals, where previously it was more elevated, I would say, it is often important to show for us that SDG 3 has spillover effects to poverty, to education, to gender equity. So these types of studies are often not amenable to a randomized controlled trial and are one of the motivators for us to do quasar experiments. One motivation for quasar experiments is the experiment simply is not feasible. We can no longer do a RCT on HIV treatment because we know it is efficacious. We cannot withhold it from a control arm. The other reason is, and that's a much more important and fundamental one in my opinion, quasar experiments typically leverage existing routine data. And the data is collected and the trial is done when no one even thinks about a trial and science. And now we are discovering in the data retrospectively that there was actually a quasi-random assignment to intervention and control arm, which means the threats to external validity that trials always carry. Trials select participants and communities and sites, and only the volunteers participate. And trials introduce artificiality into the context because they measure things that otherwise wouldn't be measured. And they teach things that otherwise wouldn't be taught. So a trial can distort nature and reality, and people are aware that they're part of a trial and they're participating voluntarily. So experiments have this external validity, quasi-experiments have the external validity advantage over experiments, and some strong quasi-experiments under conditions that are only slightly stronger than the weak conditions that need to be in place for a trial to produce an internally valid result need to be in place. So for a trial, what needs to be in place for it to produce a valid result? Probably some loss to follow-up that isn't differential, and we have need to have gotten the randomization process right. So if there was cheating during the randomization process, it will go wrong. But these are very weak conditions, and by our procedural oversight, we can ensure that nobody cheats in a randomization. We can make it public, right? We can put it online. We can have a governor be part of it and observing it. For the quasi experiments, the conditions need to be somewhat less weak, i.e. harder to meet, but we can still achieve perfect internal validity, and instrumental variables and regression discontinuity are, in my opinion, examples of quasi experiments where we can achieve complete control of controlled and of observed and unobserved confounding variables in a way that is as good as the way that a trial allows us. And then there are difference in different studies, fixed effects approaches that lead to control of confounding that is much better than without such approaches. It takes out entire categories of unobserved confounding. There's still a category left that remains uncontrolled. And then there are non-experiment regression, propensity score matching, stratification, and so on. And here's an example of, in my opinion, a relatively strong Beza experiment. Of course, all methods have advantages and disadvantages. And this is the logic of regression discontinuity, which we published for the first time in an EPI journal with a clinical application. It is an old method from psychology, the educational sciences, and econometrics. And it is very useful, in my opinion, for medicine, because the following setup is very common, nearly ubiquitous in medicine. We have a risk factor that is continuously measured, here the CD4 count, as a factor that determines whether you are eligible for HIV treatment versus not. People below this threshold of 350 are eligible at this point in time. People above are not. It could be it could be blood pressure, it could be cholesterol, it could be creatinine. In medicine, we very often measure something continuous, and then we make a binary, we dichotomize and cut the patient population into deserving of treatment because people are below a certain threshold or above, undeserving of treatment because patients are on the other side of that threshold, and then recommendations follow. And this gives us a quasi-random assignment in a small threshold around, in a small window around this threshold, because of measurement error. So measurement error, if you will, is the paradigmatic random error. And here we have a person who is exchangeable just above this threshold to a person. These are little bins of 600 people. So these people here are very likely exchangeable because measurement error has this bandwidth. And whether they are assigned to be just here or just there is really dependent on measurement error, not on anything fundamental in their disease or health state at that point of time. And then we can exploit this for effect size estimation that is causal by comparing outcomes in those people eligible for treatment, intent to treat outcomes versus those people. And here's an example. We've done this for mortality, HIV, causal impact in real life on mortality. We've done it for transmission of the virus. And here we've done it for a behavioral outcome. And I've put this result in because it's powerful. It's behavioral, it's implementation science. Here we look at retention in care, and we see that people who are below the threshold are much more likely to be retained as HIV treatment patients in care after 12 months. Everyone who comes to the clinic should come back every 6 months here, and you're much more likely to be non-retained, to never come back if you're being told you have a disease that is treatable to the extent that you can have near normal life expectancy, but currently you're not sick enough. You have to wait until we will put you on treatment. That's a very difficult public health message, in my opinion, and might have a psychological effect. You become confused, you become disappointed. You might think, I'm the type of person who never gets treatment. The other person who was there in front of the line is exactly like I am, but they are richer. And because they're richer, they're getting treatment. I'm never going to get it. In any case, whatever the mechanism, it's again the question that you ask, what is the mechanism? But here we see a significant effect of this threshold-based treatment eligibility on being retained in care after 12 months. This difference here is the effect size. And here's another example, and this again, I think, is an important motivation why we have to do implementation science. Often, when we do what we do, people say, well, I knew it's trivial, it's nothing new, it's not surprising. So we had hoped and were convinced that HIV treatment would reduce food insecurity, which is an SDG-relevant indicator. And we had many reasons, and it was very plausible to us. In fact, we find that food insecurity increases. These are all little regression discontinuity estimates. Here, the intent to treat estimates. Here, the complier average causal estimates. Causal effect size estimates in the probability of being insecure, food insecure by these measures here. Adult did not eat, adult cut size of meal, child cut size of meal of HIV treatment. And we see here, for instance, a 6 percentage point increase in the probability of an adult having had to cut the size of a meal because of HIV treatment. This was puzzling to us. It's disappointing. It's terrible. And it becomes plausible when we look at these data here. Natsai Shimbindi, one of my former PhD students at the University of the Witwatersrand in South Africa, simply asked patients when they exited from HIV treatment, how much did you pay for this visit? And then patients give us their estimates. And these may seem small numbers in dollars to you. They're high numbers in the range of catastrophic healthcare expenditures to the local community, where at the time, local household income is about 2,000 rand. If people have to expend 10%, 15% of their household income to maintain a household member on ART, it's something that can cut into, in an already impoverished situation, into financial security, into food security. And we also saw in the previous picture that food security recovered after about 3 years. And this picture seems to explain what we find when we look at the employment probability here in individual level fixed effects analysis. We compare individuals to themselves over time relative to the time when they get onto HIV treatment. So employment goes down. This is 8 years before HIV treatment, 5 years, 3 years. At point when they're initiating treatment, employment is at a low because, of course, these are the sickest patients. And now they're recovering employment, and recovery is near universal, but near universal by year 3 and 4. So it takes time for people to benefit because strength and health are coming back in their employment. And this may be the counteracting effect that explains why food security is recovered after 3-4 years on treatment. And the final example to give more hope, just from a recent study that one of our junior faculty, Jan-Walter de Neuf, has done, where we looked in a large sample here of about 300,000 individuals at the question, what is the effect of HIV treatment coverage on this important phenomenon that we have a skip generation household? It's a grandmother caring for a grandchild because a middle-aged adult has died because of the HIV epidemic. This is a common phenomenon, a common demographic structure in many sub-Saharan African settings. And here we see the causal effect of another 1% increase in HIV in treatment coverage, in ART coverage, on lives in a missing generation household. So for every 1% increase in ART coverage in countries with an HIV prevalence exceeding 5%, we have an 0.2% reduction in skip generation households. These are powerful, important effect sizes that show again that a big investment in a health campaign, in scale up of a life-saving treatment, can have effects that are important at the societal, at the demographic level even. And my very last example of a QASA experiment we just published in the BMJ, it's now, and again, that comes to your question, is now chronic HIV care. Are there lessons learned for other care? Here it is about home-based blood pressure screening. These are community health workers going to homes in China in a Chinese cohort of very elderly adults, 60 years of age and older. And we screen them, the community health workers screen them at year 2011, 2012. And then we see people again 2 years later in 2014. And we see the causal effect of screening plus counseling, depending on what the result is. In overweight people, there was counseling, lose some weight. Everybody was counseled who was hypertensive by the cutoff, 140 systolic blood pressure here, was counseled to go and follow up in the healthcare sector for a formal diagnosis. And people were counseled to eat less salt-preserved vegetables, to move more, and to exercise more. And here we see the effect size estimate in another regression discontinuity. When we estimate this formally, and since this is not pre-specified registered trial starter, we have to show robustness in sensitivity analysis. So we have to do it in a range of functional forms, with and without covariates of different categories. But we see robustly that there are large reductions to this home-based screening and counseling program on systolic blood pressure, 6 to 15 millimeter HG reduction in systolic blood pressure at the population level. This is a large effect size. We would need to invest heavily in order to achieve this through other means. Any questions about QASAR experiments? Then I'm almost done. So last, yeah.
Issue of moving beyond randomized control trials.
Yes.
So, for example, in the HIV world, we know certain interventions might work at the community level, but it's very, very, very hard to actually measure community effects. So, and that has been a big problem in terms of implementation science, because it kind of limits the ability to measure and the ability to make a strong argument to move beyond the randomized controlled trial that has so many limitations in the context of public health. So I was wondering, how can we do better in terms of maybe changing the standard of what is a scientific model and in the context of public health? We need to perhaps rethink randomized controlled trials. And what kind of community-based scientific studies could perhaps substitute or be a parallel to that golden standard?
Yeah, completely agree. So the hope that I have, and in small examples, I see it being fulfilled. The hope that I have is that governments will be increasingly willing and interested in working with us. And they could randomize nationally, representatively, or engage with us on smart QASAR experimental designs if randomization isn't acceptable, isn't possible. And we have examples where this has happened. And I think in the future, if we continue advocating for it, it's a lost policy learning chance. It's a lost opportunity for evidence-based policy. We are held to evidence-based standards here, and for medicine and implementation science, but policymakers should also be held to evidence-based standards, and they should feel they want to learn if what they do as a policy change has an effect. And one particular example to illustrate how this could work is, of course, step wedge in time and space, random or even non-random rollout of major new public health initiatives. Oftentimes, that is what happens in any case because of resource scarcity. There's often no way that Eswatini can say, we will do the new policy prep for everybody in each and every clinic in the country because nurses need to be trained. They haven't done prep to this date. They haven't learned this in their university studies. It's a new treatment. They need to be trained in the guidelines. They need to be trained in the follow-up and so on. And now this training could be step-batch randomized in a staggered fashion, giving rise to powerful causal impact estimates, validating policies.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to, I think, you know, these policymakers and decision makers and governments, we need to shift the mindset to have them think of themselves not only as consumers of evidence for their programs and policies, but as people who can generate highly relevant evidence for themselves and for other jurisdictions around the world. So it's a shift we need to make, but it's a compelling one.
Yeah, super. Thank you for these questions. It's a fantastic segue to my last very short section. So, of course, we also engage with policymakers and try to find out what is on their minds. Here's an example from a qualitative study where we interviewed 60 policymakers and stakeholders in about this very important, it's a USAID-funded study about this very important question. We have many specialized for HIV community health workers in sub-Saharan African country. What role should they play? How should they be sustained? And what role should they play in the era of the SDGs? How should this go on? How should they be governed? How should they be continuously educated? So this is important, this type of engagement. Clearly, we love it when government wants to engage with us after a study has been done, which hopefully was even initiated by government. Here, such an example. This was a 3IE-funded study. 3IE gets stimulated by government and then funds. They pair NGOs with scientists, and then they organize the minister to be there when we present our results for HIV self-testing amongst female sex workers in Kampala, in Uganda. The minister is there. It ends up in the papers. At the time, the HIV self-test was $10. Now it's down to $1.4 in Uganda. So there is a policy engagement after. There is the policy engagement before and during, and that's even more important. And here is a research stream that we do in Bangladesh, in Tanzania, in the United States, and in Germany, where we come with your question and what you are saying, Dennis. Government needs to be interested, and they are. But oftentimes, it's very hard to engage meaningfully, even though they're highly intelligent, very well trained and educated, and community stakeholders, the same thing, clients, the same thing. We are specialists in our domains, and we have so much training and so much expertise knowledge that any challenge to what I propose by government is not a very legitimate challenge. And it may be one based on budgetary reasons or so, but fundamentally, it's very hard for another person to challenge Dennis on HIV treatment, on PrEP, on, right? There are many things where we are really the world experts just because we've been doing it for decades. And now government is meant to engage with us and give us the new idea and challenge and criticize us. And it's not legitimate. So we are working here on a variant. It's a new method, but it's a variant of a very successful methods in the political sciences, deliberative workshops. We are working here on deliberative interviews where the idea is that we lift a client, a community stakeholder, a policymaker within a relatively short time to eye level so that they can be legitimate challengers, criticizers, destroyers of our thoughts, right? We come with a policy proposal and then government says, this is wrong and here are the reasons, and they do it with full information, so our ability to argue against is limited to the extent that it should be. So this is the deliberative interview. This is from a methods review that we just published in Qualitative Inquiry. One of my PhD students in Heidelberg, Astrid Werner-Rodoreda. And here we looked at all the types of interviews that exist out there in the world, by what role the interviewee plays and whether it is doxastic or epistemic in nature. And I think mostly we are traditionally in this ethnographic space here. So not an equal partner, but not totally unequal. We want to see people in their natural environment. We want to understand their meaning making, and it is mostly doxastic. And now we are trying to move to this deliberative interview where we give people the power to be legitimate challengers of us and our contribution to science. So that's my last slide. Implementation science, I think, needs a broad set of descriptive, creative, and evaluative methods, and we need to work together across these methods boundaries. Our most important findings, just out of experience, are often the null findings, often the non-inferiority findings, and often the incidental findings that emerge because we look at the data and we learn while we go. And finally, I think we need our own rules of the game and conventions. I don't know how you feel about the IRBs that we are responsible to, that hold us to a clinical standard, to a standard that makes a lot of sense in the controlled conditions in a tertiary hospital in New York, that make very little sense in a rural community in Burkina Faso. That's one of my deep felt pains, and we're working on making that better for all of us, and I hope you share this pain and are with us in this exercise to change. Thank you to funders, And I would be thrilled if you were interested in working with us, engaging with us in a European university and cross-Atlantic collaborations, I think, are promising. There are funding streams available to both sides and for shared research. And I think we are richer if we collaborate globally. Thank you.
Thank you, Till. I'm told that we have the room for just a few more minutes.